Hey, it's Warren Huart here. Hope you're doing marvellously well. I'm sitting here with the wonderful Matt Weiss. How are you, mate?
Doing well, Warren. How are you?
I'm good. No, wait, are you Matt or Matthew?
I am Matt to my friends and Matthew to my friends.
I thought it was going to be like, and Matthew to you, Warren.
No, I'm not that clever.
So you've just relatively recently relocated here.
Yeah, a week and a half ago.
That's... 2 weeks?
I can't tell. Yeah.
And I would say you've landed on your feet. This is a really nice space.
You know, I hear a lot of stories of people who, you know, come out to L.A. with a wish and a prayer and nothing but the car to sleep in, and they make it big. I'm coming out with so many advantages, man. I feel like now if I don't, then I can only blame myself.
Right. Well, fantastic. And you're sharing this place with Andrew Dawson?
Yes. Andrew is, I've known him for about 6 years. This is a lot of Life of Pablo was cut here. He was involved in the Fun Records and a lot of Kanye stuff. I should know a better list off the top of my head, but those are the only ones popping up right now. But yeah, he's an awesome engineer.
Wonderful.
And he holds this place down, and we're doing a little share on it.
Great.
Yeah.
Do you know Blake Douglas?
I don't know Blake Douglas.
He's good friends with Andrew. They were roommates for years. Blake's Jack's son, Jack Douglas's son.
Oh, okay.
So straight, I just wondered if I know Andrew and he are good friends.
Now I'm going to Wikipedia, and then I'm going to call up Andrew and be like, hey, man, by the way, about Blake.
Right. How do you know who that is? Well, this is a great space, and the weird thing is I've been here about 3 or 4 years ago when it was Brad and Chris's from Blind Lemon.
Yeah, Brad still owns
the... Did I say Blind Lemon or Blind Melon?
Blind Melon is what you said in my mind.
Okay, yeah. I actually said Blind Lemon.
Yeah.
We're going to start a new band called Blind Melon.
That's
Lemon.
That's the non-label
Orange.
Stuff. That's where the real music was at.
Apple. All right. So.
Yeah, Brad still owns the facility. He basically just rents it out. And,
fantastic.
And Drew is the main guy and has had it for a couple of years, and now I'm involved.
Wonderful.
Yeah.
Well, it's a great setup. And what are you doing? You're mainly mixing here, or are you tracking as well?
Well, I'm starting to track again, which is...
Great.
I basically stopped tracking stuff in like 2010. And I don't entirely miss it, but I do miss it a little. So I'm tracking again, but mostly mixing, yeah.
Well, you finding, because I get mixed projects, not all the time, but often enough, where I end up retracking anyway to get a better result.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Sure.
I feel like one of the lessons I am learning and I'm trying to impart upon people is our job as mixers, when we're hired to mix things, is just to make it great. So if making it great means putting some rake guitars down, replaying the tambourine, whatever it is.
Whatever it is.
Yeah.
I get this a lot because it comes up on a lot of my Facebook feed stuff and things like that, where people say, a mixer's job is to mix. If you start changing my sounds, you're fired. And my response to that is, you can fire me all you want. Fire me.
Sure.
Because I've got tons of people who are hiring me because I'm willing to do those things that
sure.
you're telling other people not to do. Look, at the end of the day, you get the job done how you want to get it done, but you get the job done. And
sure.
And when you make that record successful, which is really what our job is, to make the record successful, then you say, because I had the freaking balls to ignore these people telling me what I can and can't do and made the record
sure.
work.
Yeah, I mean, when Mark Endos mixed my stuff, it's come back sounding absolutely amazing and better still. And I'm like, I don't remember there being a string pad on that bridge. And he's like, it just felt like and a lot of guys like that, they think in frequencies. So for him, it was like, it just needed some warmth, some low mids in there. So just put like a low string pattern. And maybe it's like this loud in the mix, but
it'll make a difference.
Yeah.
But I mean, the other side of that advice too is don't go looking for things
sure.
to do. I always say, start from the assumption that the producer got it right and then go from there. And then if you run into things where you go, well, this really needs something else, or this
right.
needs, this actually has to change because maybe I can't get it to work or whatever, then you go, okay, but I don't have to limit who I am and what I do.
Right. Yeah. Do you find, CLA was saying, Chris was saying that he gets a lot of you figure it out, please, kind of stuff, where he gets like 12 guitars aside or something, and he has to find the ones that work best together.
Yeah, I get a lot of multi-mic type of stuff where the
right.
guitar was tracked with like 4 different mics and things like that. And it's like, well, first of all, if you just give me one and the guitar sounded good to begin with, like give me an EQ. I'll work that out from any one of those captures. Maybe for funsies, because I have 2 of them, I'll make a blend. But I mean, I try and encourage people as much as possible to commit, be the producer, take ownership in your work is usually how I phrase it. You know, people, it used to be people say, do you want the dry effects or do you want my effects on? Like, do you want it without the effects or with the effects? Mm-hmm. And I used to say, maybe leave the effects off. But now I say, no, just leave the effects on. The only thing I ask for is if you have reverb on the vocals, please print that to a separate stem. But,
sure.
But outside of that, if you have stuff that you like, if you like it before you send it to me, you're going to love it when you get it back. So, yeah. You know, if you like it, then yes, let's send it.
Sure. I think it's true with mastering engineers. They all say that, especially if you're doing your own fake master to make it loud and slamming to impress the band, the label, the manager, whatever, the mastering engineer needs to hear that. Because, you know, if they're trying to make something sound great, but everybody's already in love with this hyped top end or this, whatever it might be, yeah. That can really hurt. And I've heard that from a lot of mastery engineers. They just say, send me what everybody's used to hearing.
Yeah, they need a reference, yeah. Absolutely.
So if it's tough. I mean, it's like a lot of guys I know, they're mastering off, you know, just blobs of, you know, because they have no choice, because you take away the 16 plugins you might have on your master bus. I mean, maybe I'm exaggerating, the five, the six, the seven. You know, a lot of plugins on the master bus. It might not sound like they're the same song anymore.
No. It can change quite a bit. So the basic idea behind this studio is that it's supposed to be conducive for production, which at this point is everything, so there you go. Just running down the list, we've got the TubeTech CL1B, classic for vocals and basically anything, really. Spectrasonic 610, it is the fastest compressor ever made. It goes down to nanoseconds.
I have a pair, they're amazing!
They are ridiculous, and they have like a really cool sort of like, this hashy harmonic thing that happens.
This is Mark Endert's vocal compressor, by the way.
It's everybody's vocal compressor.
This is the sound of like Jack Douglas's records through the 70s, Aerosmith, you name it, everything through that. Anything East Coast guitars, vocals, basses.
Yeah. So basically everything I don't use it on, because I'm using it on drums most of the time.
Nice. No, I think drums as well, but yeah, amazing, yeah.
Because I used to use a limiter on my drums, and I find that this particular piece, it basically is a limiter, but it acts in a less, like, smooth way. It gives you a little bit more of the attitude and the aggression, so I dig it.
Do you like the 6176s?
I don't, actually. I like the preamp. I don't really care for the compressors so much, but I've been spoiled to have 1176s that I do like, and I don't think that they're bad compressors. I just don't, they don't do what I usually want from an 1176.
Right, I understand.
And I think they've been tailored a little bit to be more conducive for tracking purposes, like pianos and vocals, which are the things that usually the solo 610 stuff, well, 6176 stuff ends up on.
Right, and then the 1272 pair, looks like somebody...
That's a DIY. That might have been Brad who made that, actually.
Right.
And it sounds very good. I used it yesterday. I was tracking and ran
nice.
Out of... Yeah, I had a more complicated drum setup than I normally do. I ran out of Neve channels for the drums, and that ended up being my snare top and bottom. It sounded really nice.
Nice. Oh. These are fantastic.
Those are fantastic. That's probably the cleanest preamp. It has a little bit of a harmonic thing, but it's like looking at something through like really clean, clear water, like
right.
Fiji mountain water ponds, where you can see, you look into it, and you know you're looking through water, but everything is so clear, you can see right to the bottom. That's my technical description of what it sounds like.
Nice. Warm but transparent? No.
I hate that, I don't use the word warm. That's not my thing.
And then, I don't know these, the 4110s?
Yeah, these are sort of a... Back when Universal Audio was sort of getting itself back on the market, they made the precursor to the Solo 610 and the 710. It was the 410 series, and it's a pretty legitimately good. It's mounted in a similar way to like a 500 series thing would be mounted. So it was something that they could price reasonably low, but I think they actually made it at a loss as a branding piece.
Wow.
So it... I haven't played with it enough to really be able to start putting it into words, but I was tracking piano through it yesterday, and it did sound very good. So it sounded like a piano.
So a pair of them?
Yeah.
Wow.
These are Drew's. He likes them, apparently.
Obviously, yeah, that's great. I don't know them, but when it says mixer left and right...
Yeah, there's a rack of synths that...
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
I see.
So like a lot of the synths are going through here and stuff like that. They're, I guess for purpose-wise, they sort of function like the APIs, which we also have, where they really get the job done, and maybe anything else besides that is just going to be marketing talk.
Right. Now, what's this EQ here?
This is a Night Pro. This is like the precursor to the precursor of the Mag EQ.
Oh, right.
This is the one that is generally less desirable, but the top end specifically, the airband, is very good. The other EQs, actually, I think that they're a little underrated. I think it's actually pretty good, but you can get these on eBay pretty cheap. There's another version of this called like the NTI or something like that that's a little more sought after. But I would be willing to bet that the differences are actually pretty subtle, yeah.
Right. And then this?
Never used it. I have no idea what that thing is. It's a Lexicon preamp. I've never seen one before, never used it. Eventually, I'll use it and see what happens.
It looks like it's stereo, yeah. Yeah, stereo, recording amplifier, and direct source. Interesting.
Yeah.
It's got a standby, so I'm assuming it's tube. Yeah, all tube class A. Well, there you go. 3124s. These are awesome.
Yeah.
I love these.
This, to me, you can never go wrong with these preamps. They've got a lot of clean headroom. They don't have a huge sonic imprint. They have a little sonic imprint. You can kind of, once you get used to it, you sort of hear it. But, I mean, it's not something where it sticks out and be like, oh, my God, so much vibe. They get it done. And they never sound bad, which is, in my mind, if you're going to go for a preamp, that's the first thing I'm looking for. Just something that is going to get the job done.
Sure.
You know, not sound thin or weird. I bet you that this is used as a DI a lot. That's probably...
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Base DI or tube, yeah. And then you've got a pair of 1064s.
Yep. I love these things. I think that these are some of the best preamps ever made. They definitely have a vibe to them, especially if you go past... There's a dual-stage amp, so if you go past this where it says off here, mm-hmm. that's marking that the other amp between here and here are off. This toggles in a second preamp. And once you do that, it gets very, very, very vibey. But I think what I would want to do is to try and locate like an inline pad, which I do have one somewhere, and get that in the chain if I want to drive it that much, because it's, when it says 60, it really means 60.
Nice.
And then these are the BAEs, and I think as far as companies that have modeled Neve stuff, the BAEs, like they have a 1073 clone that I've shot out against 1073s, and 1073s, for whatever reason, seem to be like all across the map in terms of how the EQs sound, how noisy they are, things like that. I've shot them out against 1073s, and they beat the 1073s in to my ear. So.
Yeah, I mean... I'm a huge fan. I got right in when Brent started the company in 2000 building them. I one of the first people to buy them, you know, in LA, and I've used them the whole time. And then a couple of years afterwards, he got rid of the company quite early on, and Mark Lossman took over the company. And the same people still build them. They're still the same thing. It's not Brent Averill anymore. It's just BAE. Just stands for British Audio Enterprises.
Oh, gotcha. What a coincidence.
Yeah, they just kept the acronym because it's in the same building, the same people building it, so everything.
But yeah, this was my drums yesterday. This is nice. The overheads, kicks, and I had the ride cymbal and hi-hat cymbal mic'd. And normally I don't care too much for that kind of, like, it's not so important, but the ride cymbal was exceptionally unique sounding. And the hi-hats, we couldn't find hi-hats in the studio. So we took a couple of crash cymbals and we made 18-inch hi-hats.
Nice.
And it sounded awesome.
How Keith Moon of you.
Yeah.
Keith Moon used to use a crash
cymbal. Oh, man. It was like boom bap. I got to start doing that more often, actually. It sounds really cool.
Great.
So original op amps, 560B, 550B.
Yeah.
You know, classics. This is a Vintex. They're basically another Neve model. I don't remember which specifically the model, but you know, it sounds pretty good. It doesn't sound as good personally. And here goes any endorsements you might get. It doesn't sound as good as the BAE stuff in my mind, but you know, each to their own. These are like really, really aggressive limiter type compressors. They're called the Brute, and I think it's a pretty fitting description. I haven't quite gotten the swing of it yet, and I, no pun intended, because it really, like, the needles, and the sound reflects that.
Right.
But I think once I get it dialed in, like, I can get that, like, Lynn Collins kind of sound
right.
going from it.
Nice.
Which I love. Drummer expander. I think this is Brad's. I actually have one called a Punch Gate, which is a frequency-dependent model of this, and I use the Punch Gate quite frequently. This is just a clean expander gate, which at this point in the box is fine for that, in my opinion. But the Punch Gate, which is a frequency-dependent one, does something where it changes the frequency response of the transient, and you
right.
can actually center it in. So, like, if
wonderful.
You, yeah, it's really cool. So the punch gate you're not going to see here, but I've got it in the other room. Distressors, they're distressing. This is not patched in. This is some kind of a Fairchild clone that somebody using the studio built. I think it's Brad's. I really want to use it just because I love weird stuff. Like I want to
what is hear it? What it does.
I think it's a Fairchild clone. But
oh, it is?
Yeah, but it's not patched in. So
I wonder.
I just have to cry about it, basically.
More drama underneath?
Yeah, another drama. This is the 1960, which is the precursor to the 1968. It's sort of the better version in my mind, plus it's got the preamp.
Nice.
I modded my 1968 to make it sound a little bit more like this.
You're not a big fan of distressors, then?
I am a fan of distressors, actually. I use them less than I used to because the application for them for me was like workhorse compressors, and now I kind of get that going digitally. But they do have, you can get like that mid forward, that like upper mid brighter sound forward kind of thing going, especially if you start pulling in the harmonic distortion.
Yeah.
And I do use it for that. I'll use it if I want to get like that, like almost telephonic rap vocal sound that isn't like filtered. It puts the mid forward. That you'd use that for that. Or you could probably do it with like a DBX. But I mean, if I need a compressor that's going to get the job done, a distressor outboard it's never going to fail.
Yeah.
It's always going to work.
Yeah, I like them because they can sound like whatever you want them to sound like.
Right. Yeah. I mean, not everybody knows this, but the 10:1 says opto under here. It actually changes the curve to be a nonlinear curve. So everything has a nonlinear knee. The knee changes at the 1:1, 2:1, 3:1. Everything, obviously, the 1:1 is no knee. Going up to 20:1, but it's all structured linearly. The opto will change when you start adjusting the attack, when you start adjusting the release, and it changes over time too, specifically as it's releasing. And that's what opticals, that's why they have a certain sound and they're known for being transparent, because the gain reduction when you're toward the top of the signal is less dramatic. And you know, once gain reduction's already kicked in, that's when it becomes more dramatic, so it's already working.
Right, I understand.
Yeah, very good for anything that is, this applies to LA2As and anything like that. It's good for anything where most of the time you don't want the actual gain reduction being heard to the ear, which is, you know, anything that's very dynamic.
Marvelous.
Moving on here, this one I've been trying to get the feel of. This is an Allen Smart C2. It's a clone of an SSL G compressor. It's really grabby. It's a super aggressive compressor. And so, like, I was using it the other day on Mixbus, and I found that when the needle was, like, not even really moving, it was still compressing. At least it sounded like it was compressing. Mm-hmm. And I had an assistant in, and we had it where the needle was kind of moving, like, halfway up to the 4, so doing, like, what you would think would be approximately 2. Swear to God, it sounded like it was doing, like, 10, 15 dB, you know.
I have an SSL bus compressor. It's really about the attack and release, getting that done. Honestly, 99.9% of people mix it, always have it on auto.
Aha.
Once you put it onto auto, you'll start saying, oh, that sounds like an SSL.
Okay.
Yeah, it's about these attack and release, because it can just really grab it like this, and the needle doesn't move fast enough to hear it go,
yeah.
You probably heard all this kind of like, oh, you're like, what's all that stuttering-y compression? Yeah, just go to auto there and then play with it. I bet you end up like this.
Awesome.
So it's like barely grabbing. And then when it does grab, it just kind of holds it and just glues everything together.
Cool. I've got a recall once we wrap. I'm hopping over to revisions, and this is on the mix bus. And that was the one where I was having trouble getting it right. I'm going to try this setting, see if I can get
something. Yeah, just try it on auto. See, and yeah, you'd be surprised. Most people's consoles I go to, that's stuck on auto.
Oh, okay.
And I don't think I've changed mine in. I haven't changed it in a long time. Some Summit stuff.
Yep. I have yet to actually use these, but I am very much tempted to. These are basically like LA2A or LA3A kind of modeled compressors. I have yet to actually try them out, so I don't know how accurate they are or if they have their own thing going on.
My friend, unfortunately, died a couple of years ago. Brian Kallstrom had more Summit audio stuff than anybody I've ever seen in my life. He had everything, pre's,
wow,
compressors, and his stuff sounded amazing. So,
okay.
So I have fond memories. Wow.
Yeah, I've yet to use this guy. The BSS, I have a BSS, what the heck is it? The 960, which is a graphic EQ.
Mm-hmm.
But I have no idea what the heck this thing is.
I mean, obviously some kind of compression, but I...
I mean, I know this is a compressor. It's got like an expander, de-esser, like it's a multi-thing, but I mean, I don't know.
For me personally, in England, I used to always see these on PAs.
Yeah, no, this live sound stuff is what BSS is known for. Yeah. I have the graphic EQ, which it sounds very much like a graphic EQ, although it's a good quality one. Sure. When I want something to specifically sound like a little raw or a little bit like this is like a live club kind of gig sound, then I use that specifically because it calls up that sound for me.
Sure. Transient designer?
This thing is awesome. This is a really good transient designer. It's better, it's SPL, but SPL, the one that they're known for is that silver one. The silver one is not that good. This one is the good one.
Sure.
Yeah.
I have this one too, yeah.
Okay, well then you know.
Yeah, right, it was the one I bought. I don't think I'm that smart.
Well, it's also, this is the original one. The silver one is a newer one.
Oh, it is? I didn't know.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, the rule of thumb is that if it's older, it's better.
Good, I think I'm the oldest person here today, so yay for a change. All right, so anyway, the Fatso?
Yeah, Fatso is, I guess it's marketed as like a tape simulator, but it's really like a compressor meets distortion box kind of thing. It takes a little getting used to. I haven't totally got the feel for it yet, because I never had one before, but I've been trying it out.
Do you like the Tube Tech compressor?
So far, I hate this thing.
Oh, really?
Yeah. First of all, I can't get the two sides to agree with each other, for one.
That's not a good start.
That's not a good start, like, because you can't link the makeup gain, and the makeup gain is not calibrated. It's different on each side, for one, and then some things link, some things don't. I have not been able to get it to work as a stereo unit.
Right. I think I've probably used it a couple of times, but... I wonder if there's a fault with it. Maybe it needs to repair.
Maybe. But the other thing is that it's marketed as like an LA-2A kind of clone. It's called the LCA-2B. And it sounds nothing like an LA-2A at all. So, I mean, not that that's a bad thing.
I was about to say, not necessarily a bad thing.
It's not necessarily a bad thing. But in terms of like what I was originally trying it on, it was not doing what I was hoping it would do. So.
Well, I'm sure with a few weeks of playing around, you'll find the thing that you love on it.
Yeah, maybe I'll get Drew to show me how to use it.
Yeah, maybe he has something he loves on it. Now, what about the DBX? Have you tried these yet?
Nope, I have not tried them yet.
I remember the 900 series stuff. That was pretty crazy. When that came out, that was like, you buy these 900 series racks, and then you'd load them up with EQs and lots of gates. Lots of people had them for gating stuff, especially during the 80s.
Yeah, Valley people had a bunch of stuff for that.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then the 500 series came after it, and everybody, like, this is all, I'm pretty sure this is all basically 500. Yeah, it's the purple 500 series lunchbox. So it's the same idea.
Now, this is your stuff up here we were talking about earlier, the Bricasti.
Yeah, I've got all of my gear in storage here.
Is that the proper pronunciation, by the way, Bricasti or Bricasti? How do you?
I think it's Bricasti.
It is Bricasti.
I mean, being from Philly, it's however it comes out of my mouth. That's how it's pronounced. Yeah, I mean, I'm so new here, I don't even have a long-term place yet. I'm not moving into, I'm subletting. I move in October 1st, so I'll be able to set up my home studio, but until then, everything's in storage here in the studio.
I see.
These are the three units that I use on every mix, though, so I had to pull them up and hook them up.
So the M7.
Yeah.
I know that Bob Horn loves this, too.
Yep.
I hear great things about it. And Chris O'Dowdy has one as well, so they're obviously very popular for mixers.
Yeah, a lot of people like them. I happen to be one of them. Whooper has one. I keep calling him Whooper. Whooper has one. He loves it.
And then the Kush Audio?
Yeah, that's Clarophonic. It's a great finisher for a mix. It gives it that extra little bit of lift to make it come out of the speakers, and it's literally one of the settings is called lift. And it does exactly what it says.
I have to try this out because so many people I know and respect use them.
You're welcome to borrow it anytime.
Oh, you shouldn't say that. I'll be leaving with it. No.
Well, except for today because I'm doing recalls. I know. So any other time.
And then the 160 SL. I've never used the newer one, so what do you think of it?
This is an awesome compressor. This is a compressor where anything that you want to do with a compressor, you can do it with this. The tone of it sounds amazing. And this one specifically is defunct in a really cool way. The limiter path, the bypass doesn't disengage the entire circuit. It just disengages the actual compressor part of it. So if you want to turn this into a soft clipper, you take out the peak stop button, And you can use this to drop your headroom.
Yeah.
And you get a really, really nice soft clipper, which if you're used to the sound of like things being run out of an MPC really hot, like from like the hip hop guys, like that's a very specific sound. I can replicate that sound with this circuit.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
That's smart. Yeah, I don't, I look at them and I go, oh, it's a really complicated looking like 160, so I get put off.
Yeah.
Because I'm so used to 160, which is like auto attack and release, you know.
It's all of their compressors put into one device, basically, with with a fancier circuit path and, you know, Jensen transformers. Ooh.
And nice and blue.
And nice and blue. There's a purple one. It's too weird being purple. It looks like it's like a Bozo the Clown would be using it. But it's the same schematic. It just uses a lower grade of components when you get the purple one. So, you know.
Right. So stick with the blue.
You stick with the blue.
Now there's some mixing stuff over there. I see some lexicons and what have you.
Yeah, you get your standard 42s and things like that, which, you know, that's a pretty common delay. You got the Eventide. He's got the 3000. I actually have a DSP 7000, which is like the like tripped out, this is like designed for synth kind of version. It's not racked up. But, you know, model H3000 is the classic. That's the one that...
Still love mine.
Yeah, it's a great unit.
The the Line 6, so like an Echo Farm.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
I didn't know they made a 19-inch rack mount of it. I have a PCM42. Those sound great. And you're right, the Yamaha, the SPX, is a go-to for so many great guys.
Yeah.
Over on the other side, what are those Aphex?
You know, I don't know what the Aphexes are. I mean, I'm used to the exciters, but I guess this is just some kind of a channel routing type of thing.
No idea. And then an old Altec mixer underneath?
Yep. I tried to get that in line, and I had a little bit of trouble with it. I think only one of the outs is patched or something like that, so it's another one where I'm going to have to talk to Drew about it.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, if you use the Soundtoys radiator, that's the radiator.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Very nice indeed. All right. Well, we've got one last thing over here. You were talking about you're only really using this specifically for monitoring.
Yeah, this is basically like a seriously overpriced monitor switcher for us. But it's a summing mixer. But I don't use it for summing. I don't believe Drew uses it for summing. But, I mean, it's got everything else that you could want from it. So, you know, if a producer wants to plug up his laptop, there's an in over there. Just slide this forward.
Great.
Got talk back, and you can assign your talk back to different cues and things like that. And if you really want... you can use it as a summing mixer.
I know Brad Wood does. He sums everything through it. He loves it. Maybe this one doesn't have the... Yeah, he's got the one with the... Oh, no, there's the Silk. Yeah, that's it. You should try it just to hear what it sounds like. Cause
it's like an EQ or something like that?
It's a sort of basically a saturation.
Oh, it's a saturation
thing? It's a kind of, you know, a saturation tape kind of...
Okay.
Brad, I like Brad's work, and he did a mix for me, which was pretty... It was pretty nice. And one of his things was, he broke it down for me, was using that. Yeah, I'll try it. See if you...
Yeah.
I know Rupert spent a long time trying to bring in lots of different, you know, transform... I think it switches types of transformers. I don't actually know. People that have watched the Brad one remind me what it does, but I know it's pretty special.
Well, I'll try it out. I'll see what happens.
Marvelous.
This is converter specifically for the monitor path. Monitors are JBLs, and I think these are Westlakes, but obviously they're not exactly branded very clearly.
Wow. They're huge. Do you use them for playback?
I use them to mix, believe it or not. They actually sound... They get a little, like, honky, but they really give you the bass in a great way, and they sound accurate. Like, they're very detailed. They're response-wise, though, they do center things a little bit more in that 800 hertz kind of 1K thing more than... you would expect them to. The JBLs are really flat, so most of the mixing is there.
All right, let's check out the live room.
Just walking in, you hear the sound change.
What's the mic?
That mic is a Lucas CS1. It is a fantastic microphone.
I met these guys at Summer NAMM.
Terry and Oliver?
Yeah, really nice guys.
Yeah, unfortunately Oliver passed away, which is...
When?
He passed away like 2 years ago.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But the design's brilliant. They made some EQs that I have been trying to get my hands on for the longest time. I think they were just called the Lucas EQs, and they just sound amazing.
We're talking Lucas as in Terry Manning?
Yeah, Terry Manning.
Oh, wow. No, there's a new microphone company called Lucas.
Really?
Yeah. It can't be the same one.
Well, I know that he's trying to go back into production again.
I wonder if it's the same one. Terry Manning. No. I'm glad. This is so great you're talking about this. Okay, so Terry Manning. I contacted him a few years ago because Terry used to run Compass Point in the Bahamas.
Yep.
And he makes a thing called a deceiver, which is what it is. It's a 19-inch rack mount, and Dave Jordan has one. In fact, Dave Jordan has tons of Lucas stuff. Those EQs are incredible. They're like just big, huge.
Yeah, they sound amazing.
Amazing.
I've been dying to...
Yeah, so I used to have a pair of those on my mix bus. It was amazing. But he has this thing called a deceiver, and what it is he loads all of the inputs so they're just like a guitar pickup. And what Dave did when he was making records in the 90s and doing all those kind of Alice in Chains huge rock records is he would run like 4-5 different amps simultaneously, and he'd split from this, he'd go in and then split.
Oh.
And it's just clean as a whistle, all the phase, the polarity is perfect.
That's awesome.
And it's made by Terry Manning, and it's called the Lucas Deceiver.
I've seen other things that split off to the amps, and I feel like they've always compromised the sound, so I've always just done the one amp thing.
Right.
But I've seen people set things up like that, and I've always thought that was cool.
Yeah, it's Lucas Deceiver.
I
think we're probably going to drive the prices of his stuff up, because occasionally it comes out on eBay, and it usually goes for a pretty good price, but...
Okay, don't post this. No, you know what? I hope Terry goes back into business. I know he's been planning on doing it, and he deserves every penny that he gets for his stuff, because he's...
Well, he was a great engineer. His resume is insane.
Yeah, he's a fantastic producer, too. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, more power to him.
Yeah.
And he's got a great eye for photography. Out of all that, really, basically, Terry is awesome.
I'm so sad they closed Compass Point down.
Yeah. It's hard to... It's a very difficult business, music. You know, I don't envy... Well,
selfishly, I just always wanted to go to Compass Point in the Bahamas and make a record.
Absolutely. You know, but it might... Things like that are always opening up, too. So, I mean, who knows?
Sure.
The bottom line is things come and go, change. You know, I won't always be in here, and, you know, it's just facts of life, I guess.
Yep. So guitar-wise, there's some nice collection. There's an Epiphone here.
Yeah, I mean...
Classical.
This is where you need to talk and I need to listen, really.
Yeah, nice. I don't know what this is, but I'm going to pick it up. Oh, it's one of those cigar box guitars.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, minor chord. I'm so sad. Anyway, so...
It sounds very much like a Western...
Oh, wretch. Yeah. That's beautiful.
Yeah, it's a blues guitar.
Yeah, that's gorgeous. Oh, can we just put this in the back of the car?
I mean, you could. I don't know how the LAPD treats theft, but, you know.
Now, what is this? Like a baritone? This is huge. Yeah.
Yeah, it's got an extra string on it.
You can't hear on little camera mics, but, you know, on these mics, but...
Sounds like it needs a little tune-up, but...
It's awesome.
Warren's next album.
Yeah.
If you ever want to track here and get some access to some of this gear, you know, you just give me a call.
Well, there's some gray amps. There's some really cool amps here.
Yeah.
There's a Falcon, Gibson Falcon, which is superb.
We recorded through this Gretsch yesterday. I can only assume by looking at it that it's from like the last, maybe it was like, you know, it looks like it's about 400 years old, maybe five.
Yeah. Guitar, regular. Accordion or guitar.
That's
guitar,
right.
Treble.
That's right.
Accordion or guitar.
You can plug an accordion into that. Yeah, it's a very deep bassy kind of sound. It breaks up really easy. Like, so you really have to find a sweet spot. Otherwise, it's like if you change your dynamic, you're just crunching forever.
I love it's made by the Fred Gretsch Company.
Wow, so then it really is from the 1600s.
Beautiful, and then a Vox.
Yeah, I mean
AC15.
It sounds like a Vox. It's very loud, and. It's very presence-y, as Voxes usually are.
So it's an AC30. It's a weird one because it's a single 12, not a dual. But yeah, I don't know this particular one, but I'm sure it sounds great.
I feel like I've seen that one used for acoustics running DI. And I think there's another amp that's specifically for that purpose around here too. I think this guy, I'm pretty sure the main purpose of this right here is for like the Rhodes or for an acoustic hooked up to it.
I don't know. I mean, I know the acoustic amps. I always think of, so it's like a little bass amp. I always think of...
Oh, you know what? You're right. I just totally, in my mind, I saw the word acoustic, and then it just got lodged in there, like, subconsciously.
No problem. Yeah, a little bass amp. Jaco always played acoustic bass amps. Mm. They were really great. Now, here's a beautiful old Princeton here.
Yeah, we were rigging up bass to guitar amps. We tried an amp peg, and we didn't really like what we were getting, so there's actually another amp back in here, which I should probably pull out because I need to do that to break it down. Anyway,
seeing a Coles here as well.
Yeah, I use the 4038 for Guitar Cab, and I really have yet to find anything else that I like better.
Ampeg Rocket bass here.
Yeah, that was beautiful. The one that we were trying to. It just wasn't working out for what we were going for, so we ended up using this guy.
This Gibson Ranger just looks gorgeous. Oh, look at that. That just looks the part.
I'm telling you, man, you give me a call.
We're going to come in and do some guitars.
Man, I would love to. I would absolutely love to be involved in that.
And then...
one of the best Rhodes you'll ever hear.
Yeah, it's gorgeous. That's gorgeous. Very nice indeed.
Yeah.
Especially for a guitar player. I had one more chord in me and then I was done. Well, great. I mean, it's a good sized live room.
Yeah. Probably looks a little smaller with all of my stands and, you know, we were doing drums, bass, guitar, vocals. So,
yeah. Love the jazz bass. That's beautiful. I always loved that kind of poop brown color, believe it or not.
That is the actual name if you open the Crayola box.
Beautiful. And now, when I first arrived, the first thing I freaked out about was the Les Paul recording bass, which is over here. And those of you that are knowledgeable will know that the Les Paul recording guitar was this very underrated guitar that was Les Paul's main guitar. And people didn't realize. But the thing about it is the guitar version of this had an XLR output and was low impedance. And these pickups were low impedance. And this was Les Paul's favorite and favored instrument. And this is beautiful. It's like playing a Les Paul neck, but for bass. So it's total guitar player's heaven, you know. Gorgeous. Love it. This could definitely make its way into the back of the car.
I'm telling you, man, I've got them on speed dial. Yes, one of the greatest beautiful features about this studio is the alarm system. And security cameras.
Beautiful.
And the PlayStation.
And PlayStation.
Yeah, the PlayStation. And the LA-2A.
Gorgeous. It's a pair of 1031s there. Do you use those?
The 1031s?
Yeah.
The Genelecs?
Yeah.
No. I'm not a fan of Genelec monitors.
I do. I've been using them for years.
You know what? Monitors are a really personal thing.
This is beautiful.
Yeah.
Whoa. like I said, as a piano player, I'm like a great guitarist.
Well, one of the cool things for me is that I'm not a good instrumentalist by any stretch, but having all this stuff at my disposal, I will be able to get more accustomed to the individual sounds of specific guitars, specific pianos, specific this, specific that. And I think that's probably my weakest facet as an engineer.
Right.
So I'm glad to be in a position where I can improve on that level.
Great. Yeah, I agree. Always be learning.
Absolutely.
We've got a few extra guitars down there. I see some Strats. I see a Silvertone. Yeah.
There's no shortage of stuff, really, is what it comes. And it's all usable stuff, which I think is really important, because a lot of times you go into a studio and there's stuff there, but it's not very good.
This is like looks like one of these Japanese 60s kind of...
That's the what's the name of the video game? Rockstar.
That's great. Just fun. These were like free when you were a kid. Now they're like... becoming collectible, because everybody wants things that are different. Beautiful Silvertone. I remember you could get these with the guitar amp in the case. Again, very collectible. Couple of nice Strats. That one's a Korean one, I believe. Yeah. This one, I don't know what this is. I think it's American, isn't it?
That's the Colgate. No one. Okay, I thought it was funny.
Oh, okay.
I think it's a Fender. But.
Yeah, it's a Fender. Yeah, it's an American one, yeah. This is a...
And the only instrument not featured in this video is my Sadowski bass.
Which,
yeah, it was an original 1970s custom-built Sadowski.
Right.
It's very, very, very clean tone, very dark. But really heavy, very good, very easy to play. It was my dad's.
There's a baritone Strat over there, Squire one, and then there's a Jaguar there. So nice combination, and of course the Telecaster.
No.
Yeah, very lovely.
So the point being is, you know, I'm now more excited about tracking because, you know, a lot of the times with tracking, you get people who don't really have fantastic instruments, and that's difficult to deal with. But now there's no shortage of fantastic instruments.
Nice.
Yeah.
Lovely. What's this mic over here?
It's a Manly Reference.
It's, yes.
It's very, very clean, very punchy, very, you know, if you don't want something that's going to give or take anything that isn't there, it's a good mic.
Wonderful. Yeah, I think when I was in Nashville, I know a couple of guys that love these. They were really freaking out about these.
They're fail-safe. You can never really go wrong with them. And whenever you hear commercials come on TV, 99% of the time it's cut through one of those. And then, you know, outside of that, we've got a lot of, like, workhorse-style mics, E609s, Beta 52, got a couple of active Royers over here, the 122s.
Yep.
And then a whole host of condensers, dynamics, SM7s, RE20s. The whole concept behind the studio is thinking production and knowing that you need to get stuff done. So there's stuff like, you know, when you need switchers, when you need cables, when you need an iPhone charger, when you need something to plug in a laptop, like it's with those considerations in mind. And so it's, you know, it's not about having this huge recording console that's only going to get used to put the laptop up on. The money has gone into other things that are perhaps more pragmatic and less flashy.
Lovely. Well, I think they did a great job with the room.
Yeah.
It's great. I think when I was here that time, I think they built this whole entire thing, didn't they?
They might have.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure, but...
I can't remember.
I mean, wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, I mean, somebody had to, but I think it took some work and everything. Yeah, I love the ceiling.
Yeah. Skylights.
Yeah. It's always nice to have some daylight in the studio.
You know, I can't live without it, man. Yeah. I've been spoiled. I was stationed in front of, like, bay windows, and I was able to configure it in a way where I was getting good frequency responses, everything like that. So I had the whole daylight in front of me the entire time I was working.
And great.
Wonderful. Never want to go back to a windowless studio.
No, I don't blame you. I'm the same way. My studio. Now, are these big tenors, are they yours or?
No, these are Drew's, or maybe Brad's, but I'm pretty sure they're Drew's. I've never really been partial to tannoy speakers, but I know that some people love them.
Yeah, the little golds are favorites of mine, kind of a classic standard speaker. I don't know these so much, but I've been in studios I haven't. So, you know, I was raised on NS10s and then Genelex, because Genelex were the first kind of powered speakers that people had. And that's just what I'm used to. But there are lots of great companies, and Tannoy Little Golds, well, what Jordan used, a lot of people, they had the George Massenburg redesigned crossover in them, and they were like, those were the ones that people loved.
Yeah.
Really nice. Oh, not George Massenburg, sorry. Mastering Lab.
Oh.
Yeah, I got that wrong. Right. So I'll be corrected already, but I did correct myself. The Mastering Lab crossovers.
Yeah, I lovely. Mean, one of the things that I found immediately moving is that, you know, monitoring being such a personal thing, every monitor sounds bad when you stop using the ones you like, no matter how good they are.
Right.
So, like, I've been working on KEF 1032s, powered by Bryson, for, right. you know, for 4 years now. So I'm super used to those speakers.
Are you going to bring them back in here and use them?
I'm going to use them in my home studio. I've gotten myself used to the JBLs. Right. So I feel very comfortable mixing on this particular setup, and wouldn't really want to change it. And actually, these are significantly more detailed than the KEFs. So that's the tour of the studio. You can edit that down to 12 seconds.
And, the 192s, are they being used?
No.
So it's the Apollo that's being used there?
Yeah, Apollo's being used.
Interesting.
Yep. 192s are, they're a little antiquated at this point.
Interesting.
The new Pro Tool HDs sound good, though.
Great. So so you guys are both mixing using the Apollo?
Yeah.
Oh.
For my home rig, I have Lynx Auroras, which are also very good.
Yeah, those are great. I have a room with Lynx in them. Really beautiful. Well, thank you ever so much.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really great. And how are you enjoying Los Angeles so far, your first couple of weeks here?
You know, I'm getting used to the driving and right. Enjoying pretty much an endless sea of amazing Mexican food.
Yes, which we just had for lunch.
Yes, which we just had for lunch. And yeah, I mean, it's been cool. It's very convenient to be able to, if I want to work with somebody, I don't have to set it up over the internet. I can literally just go over and that's, or have them over here. And that's a big part of this whole thing.
Absolutely.
And you don't realize it until you're doing it that way.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, I think it was even Dan who was saying to me, he's like, oh, you know, where'd you get all these, how do you get to interview all these people? I'm like, because they're all in LA.
They're my neighbors.
Yeah.
Dan is the guy who runs the Pro Audio Files, for those who don't know.
Right.
And yeah, no, I mean, it's exactly that. It's that you drive 15 minutes and you go, hey, you.
Yeah.
Come on over.
But Nashville has a great scene too.
Nashville does have a great scene. Yeah. Vance Powell and so many.
Dave Cobbs over there.
Yeah, Dave Cobbs. Like, this, yeah. I mean, Nashville. The Nashville is, there's a different vibe to Nashville.
Sure.
There's a certain quality of get-it-doneness that is pretty much unparalleled. I think that the idea of getting it done is sometimes underrated. We spend a lot of time thinking about how to make something that's perfect and magical, and the reality is that something that's perfect will never happen, and something that's magical is probably not perfect. So,
sure.
So we catch a moment, and we find that moment, and we go with it, and we roll with it. And particularly on the mixing side of things, it's very hard to do that because we're never in a single moment.
Sure.
When we're recording, there's a single moment, and you either catch it or you don't. When you're mixing, you're going over that single moment again and again and again. So finding another single moment in which you do something, and you don't even necessarily know what you did, but you were playing around with it, suddenly something happened, and it just there's a sense. It goes, okay, this is... something's working with this. And you look at the settings and you go, well, that doesn't make any sense, but okay, fine, whatever. And then you move on, but you keep it that way. And I think that when you have that mentality of getting it done, not thinking too hard about it, not trying to make it perfect, and not going back over everything, and just letting it be and trying to feel what gives you the right thing, that's what makes things great, when that connects.
I agree. I remember those funny kind of moments I had with early Pro Tools, like 90s Pro Tools, where sometimes it would magically route wherever it wanted to. So you have this electric guitar and it's like, chang, chang, suddenly it's... a phaser would come in, there's delays. Other effects you have would just suddenly route. And I remember the first time restarting and getting upset, and then the second time I was like, quick, print it! And you solo the guitar, and then print this thing, because it was just all probably, yeah.
Hit the button now.
Yeah. Press record. Yeah, so happy accidents.
Oh, yeah.
Which is pretty much all of many of the things that were invented that we love.
Well, I don't even know if it's necessarily accidents all the time. Sometimes we're going for something, and it just gets there because you feel this is the feeling. You know, sure, intuitively, that and as you get better at doing these things, as I'm sure you know, you get more in touch with that feeling.
Right.
And so capturing that is really, I try to get myself in that state of mind and in that place of being as much as possible.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, so it's about not going. And so many people have said, yeah, this song that's the smash hit that everybody loves, I wrote this in like the middle of the night, just came to me. I wrote it on a napkin, and you know what I mean? And so many great things just come that way. They just show, sure, up and you just roll with it.
And then sometimes the exact reverse. It took me 10 years and finally I figured it out.
It's that happens too.
I think the no rules thing is the...
It's no rules, but the bottom line is if you're spending 10 years on something or if you've done it in 30 seconds, it's literally the exact same instinct. It's that you didn't get that feeling that it was right, and you never did until 10 years down the line, and then finally, or it came right away and you had that feeling and you just, there it was. But it was that same...
Sure.
Yeah.
When it's great, it's great.
When it's great, it's great.
Marvelous. Thank you ever so much.
Absolutely. One more.
One
there
more.
Yeah.
All right, so leave a bunch of comments and questions below, and I will throw him under the bus, literally, because he's already there.
Cool.
Have a marvelous time recording and mixing, and we'll speak to you again soon.